Please send us your views and ideas regarding the program which you have just viewed to the following email address, feedback@madanichannel.tv, or text to the following numbers 0301261217 and 0312492131389. Please take note that the programs and other transmissions aired on Madani Channel may contain clips of various occasions and audible editing.
Sallu ala al-Habib sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad niyyatul mu'mini khayrun min amalihi. Musliman ki niyat iske amal se behtar hai. Allah azza wa jalla ki rza paane aur sawab kamane ki gharz se silsila dekhne se pehle achhi achhi niyatein farma lijiye. Allah ki rza ki khatir ilm-e-deen hasil karunga, seekhkar dusron tak neki ki daawat pahunchaunga, khaas khaas baatein likhunga, abbal ta aakhir dekhunga. Sallu ala al-Habib sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin was salatu was salam ala sayyidil mursalin amma ba'd. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام عليك يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك وحبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا نبي الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا نور الله. Alhamdulillah, there are many countless blessings and virtues of reciting the Ridat Akut on the beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is narrated in the famous book Rahatul Qulub. There is a beautiful incident where it states that during the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there was an incident that happened where a beggar came onto the street, and this person, he was destitute, he had no money, and so he was asking people, and he says that he went before some disbelievers and he was asking them for some money and for some food, and they started to mock him, they started making fun of him, and so this person, he felt dejected and he felt sad, and these people that were mocking him, they saw Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu at a distance, and they said to him that, why don't you go and ask him, let's see what he's going to give you. So this beggar, this destitute person, he goes in front of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he asks him, he says, I'm destitute, I have no money, I have no food. And he says, at that time, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he had nothing in his possession that he could give him, no money or any food that he could give him. But he knew that these people are trying to mock him, they're trying to make fun of him, they're trying to mock Islam. So what did he do? Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that he asked that person to put his palm before him. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he recited Rud-e-Fak 10 times and blew in this person's palm. And then he says to him that close your palm. And he did. And he says, I open your hand when you go in front of them, these believers who are mocking you. So he does as he is told, and he goes before them, and they ask him, what did you get, what did he give you? And he goes in front of them, and he opens his palm, and his hand, and what does he find? That his hand is full of gold coins. And he says, by witnessing this incident, this miracle of Gurudev, then people who before they were mocking Islam, they were making fun of him, by witnessing this incident, they accepted Islam and entered the fold of Islam. So my dear family brothers, respected elders, alhamdulillah, we see that reciting Gurudev Path, there are many countless and non-ending benefits of this. So inshallah, we should make it our habit as well, as much as we can, during the day, make it our habit to recite Gurudev Path upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam abundantly. And inshallah, in order to bless our gathering as well, let's all recite together. Sallu ala al-Habib. Sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. My dear son, brothers, come close. And with the intention of respecting the bayan, if you can, sit on your knees in the tahiyyat position. And then if you get tired, sit however you please. And try to listen to the bayan with good intention. That inshallah, whatever we learn, we are going to act upon this. And we are going to try and pass it on to other Muslims as well. Sheikh Shahabuddin Sohrawardi, he mentions in his book, that when people read and study the waqiyat of the Buzurgan-e-Deen, of the Awliya-e-Kiram, of the Sufyan-e-Kiram, when they read about them, and they read that these people, they used to spend the whole night in worship. These people, some of them, they used to read their Fajr namaz with the wudu that they had done for Isha namaz. Some of them, they used to spend days, nights, months and years in the jungle doing the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. Some of them, they used to eat very less. Some of them used to sleep very less. Others used to talk very less. And he says that when we read about these things and we try to attain that status, we try to do them things ourselves, but we are unable to do so, then we become dejected. And we start to think that we can't do these things. But Sheikh Shahabuddin Sohrawardi mentioned a beautiful thing. He says that there is no need to be dejected. There is no need to be dejected in our minds. Why? He says, remember the narration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which states that whoever you love in this world, you will be with them on the Day of Judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever you love in this world, you will be with that person on the Day of Judgment. Now my dear family brothers, alhamdulillah, we are here, we are gathered today in this ijtima, in this gathering, to hear about somebody very, very special. To hear about a very special personality. And this hadith path, the narration that we have just heard, tells us that whoever we love, we will be with that person on the Day of Judgment. Now let's listen for a second what it means to love somebody. What does it mean to have love for another person? Now this time, love is that thing that they say in this country, in the Western society, that love is blind. Love is that thing, unconditional love, that you don't look at any parameters. There's no boundaries to it. Love makes you love that thing or that person without any condition, without any boundary. And alhamdulillah, if you look at the history of Islam, if we look at the book of the books of history in Islam, we will see that the love is a fundamental part of our deen. If you look at the times of the Sahaba Ikram, where have we forgotten the waqiyat of Sayyidina Bilal Habshi radiallahu ta'ala anhu? When he was persecuted, the kuffar were persecuting him, and they were mistreating him, they placed rocks on his chest, but still he proclaimed the love of Allah Azza wa Jal and his beloved Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You look at the other companions. You look at the Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. How severe was his love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's an incident where it says that he is traveling with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And during the journey, at some point of the journey, he takes his camel to the front. At some point he goes to the right hand side. At another point he goes to the left. At another point he goes behind. And people will ask him, what is the reason for this? Why were you doing this? And he says that this thought came in my mind that somebody might attack us from the front, so I used to go to the front so that I take the attack on myself and it doesn't harm the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, when I saw that somebody might attack from the right, I used to go to the right to take the attack on myself. When I saw somebody might attack from the left, I used to go to the left. And when I saw somebody might attack from behind, I used to go behind. That, my dear Sangha Buddha, is true love. And if we look through the history from the companions and following on from that, love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and love for various things in Islam is a fundamental part of our deen. Our ulama, our scholars, what do they teach us? They teach us to have love and respect for everything. We have love and respect for the Holy Quran. This is why when we get the Holy Quran, we kiss it, we place it in a high place. We have love and respect for the masajid. We have love and respect for our teachers, for our ulama. And importantly, we have love and we have respect for the awliya kiram, for the friends of Allah Azza wa Jal. And my dear family, we are lucky. Honestly, we are lucky, we are fortunate, and no matter how much we thank Allah Azza wa Jal, it is less that we are amongst those people who love Amir Ahl-Sunnah. Alhamdulillah, we are gathered today to hear, spend a few minutes to talk about this great personality. This great person who has changed the life of not one person, not just a handful of people, not just 100 people, not 1,000 people, but literally hundreds and thousands of people all over the world. And inshallah today we're going to talk about him and we're going to learn about his life. It says that the sign of a wali, a friend of Allah Azza wa Jal. How do we identify who is a friend of Allah Azza wa Jal? What is the sign of such a person? It says that the sign of such a person is that Allah Azza wa Jal will put the love of this person in the hearts of the people. Allah Ta'ala will make the people love that person. And what can be said about Amir Ahl-Sunnah? What can be said about that personality? Where today, hundreds and thousands of people proclaim the love for this person. You know, if it was just a handful of people, or if it was just people in his locality who loved him, then maybe you could say, alright, that's understandable. You know, those people, they spend time with him, of course they're going to be close to him. They sit with him, they're going to be close to him, they're going to have love for him. But Amir Ahl-Sunnah is that personality where his love sees no boundaries. His love sees no territorial boundaries or any secular boundaries or any boundaries of color or race or language. Amir Ahl-Sunnah is that personality where a kafila comes all the way from China and the brothers, they sit in his company. They do not understand a word of his language. They do not understand a word of the Urdu language, but they are sitting there, they are listening to the Madni Muzakara, and there are tears flowing from their eyes. And the people, they asked him, they said, you don't even understand what he's saying. You don't even understand the words that is coming out of his mouth. And they said that we don't understand his language, we don't understand the word of Urdu, but every single word that Amir Ahl-Sunnah said, it went straight into our heart. And they say, my dear son of brothers, that what comes from the heart goes to the heart. And that, my dear son of brothers, is the personality of Amir Ahl-Sunnah. And alhamdulillah, as I said, we are lucky. We are very lucky that we have nisbat with this person. We have nisbat with this great person. And what also they say about the awliya. They say that the kings of this world, the rulers of this world, what is their territory? What do they rule over? They rule over property. They have control of country. Yeah, they dictate over countries and people and land. But the awliya, the friends of Allah Azza wa Jal, they don't rule over people or over territory or over land or over countries. The awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal, the friends of Allah Azza wa Jal, they rule over the hearts of the people. And my dear sangha, let me give you an example of how Amir Ahl-Sunnah rules over the hearts of his followers and the people who like him. Let me give you an example. From here, you know, we live in such a society, we live in such a culture here, whereby many of the youngsters will appreciate this and they can relate to this as well. But when you go through college and university, and when you're at school, and when you're out chilling out with your friends on the street, there's so much importance placed on what everybody wears. You could wear a perfectly fine pair of clothes, a pair of jeans, trainers. But if they're not a designer label, if they're not such and such a designer label, then people will make fun of that person. People will make fun of you. Why? Because you're not wearing designer clothes. Perfectly fine clothes, but they'll make fun of you because they're not designer clothes. Now this time we're living in such a society, living in such a culture, there are still people, there are still brothers born and bred in this country, you will see them walking on the street from head to toe. They are dressing according to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that, my dear Sahabi, is the karamat of Amira and the Sunnah. Efforts of Amira and the Sunnah showing on our brother, and alhamdulillah, that is evidence of how Amira and the Sunnah controls the hearts of these people. How Amira and the Sunnah can influence. He might be sat in Karachi in Pakistan. He might be sat in a completely different country, hundreds and thousands of miles away, but Amira Ahlul Sunnah has influence over me and you here in this country. Amira Ahlul Sunnah, when he says ma'asamus to many of the youngsters living in this country. And alhamdulillah, many people do work. Many organizations do work. Many ulama spend time and do the work of tabligh, do the work of deen. But let me tell you this, that when you see a young child, 10 years old, 11 years old, 12 years old, and he is dressed from head to toe according to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith of my brothers, that is the work of none other than Amir Ahlul Sunnah. That is, the ulama themselves proclaim this. The ulama say that for so long we have been doing work, for so long we have been trying to guide the people. But when we see youngsters, when we see a whole Ijtima full, when we see a whole Janus full of youngsters, dressed from head to toe according to the Sunnah, then we are majboor that we have to say that is the work of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. And that is the reality, my dear family brothers. But we might think to ourselves that this beautiful environment of Dawat Islami, these thousands and thousands of youngsters who are of Imam Sharif on the head, who are dressed according to the Sunnah, all these masajid, these ishtamas, these madani kaflas, we might think it happened overnight. We might be thinking to ourselves that Amir Ahlul Sunnah had this seat, and he came and he sat on this seat, and now he is enjoying, he is reaping the rewards of that. Let me tell you the reality of how much effort Amir Ahlul Sunnah put into Dawat Islami to get it where it is today. Let me tell you that Dawat Islami, this what you see before you, is the effort, the days and the nights of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. You could say that this is the blood, sweat and tears of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. He worked day and night. He worked restlessly to bring Dawat Islami to the position where it is today. And says, and he had a difficult upbringing, my dear family brothers. It wasn't easy. It says Amir Ahlul Sunnah, at the age of one, approximately 1 year old, Amir Ahlul Sunnah, his father passed away. A few years later, his elder brother passed away. A few years after that, his mother passed away. Imagine, my dear family brothers, all of us here, let's think to ourselves, growing up, without your mother, without your father, without your elder brother. What a tough situation that is. It's hard enough managing your own affairs, let alone being responsible for your whole family. This was the position that Amir Ahlul Sunnah found himself in. And life was so tough for him at times. A brother was telling us today that Amir Ahlul Sunnah, he mentions a waqia that once, where he lived in the house that he lived in, he says that he could hear young children who were running up to their father, And they were proclaiming the father's name. And Amir Ahlul Sunnah says, I had this wish in my heart that if my father was around as well, then maybe I would go to him in the same way. That is the situation that Amir Ahlul Sunnah found himself in. My dear family brothers, and then still look at how much work, how much effort he made to progress and to do the tabligh of the deen. It says, there was an occasion when Amir Ahlul Sunnah, he went in the early days of Dawat Islami. He says that he went to this masjid to give a dars, to give a bayan. And he went there, and before the namaz, he said to the imam sahib that we're going to have a bayan after the namaz, if you could do an announcement. And the imam sahib agreed, and then he came to finish the namaz, and the media listeners, he says that every single one of the namazis that was in that masjid walked out of the door, not a single one of them stayed. And he says, even to such an extent that the imam of the masjid, who had just led the jamaat for namaz, he didn't even say he walked outside of the masjid. Now think to yourself, my dear son, because the media listeners didn't go there to ask them for money. He didn't go there to get something from them. He went there purely to teach them something about the deen, to teach them something for their own benefit, so yet they walk out of the door. Now if you imagine me and you, what would we do in that situation? We would probably walk out of the door and follow them as well. But what did the media listeners do? This is a sign of his character. This is a sign of his taqwa. And this is a sign that amongst the many signs that he is a wali of Allah Azza wa Jal. And what did he do? Amir al-Sunnah, he didn't walk out. He didn't give up hope. What did he do? He took out a comb from his pocket. He put that comb before him, and Amir al-Sunnah gave dirt in front of that comb. And that is what he did, my dear family brothers. Today, that Amir al-Sunnah, at that time, when people, the Mahdi walked out of the masjid and there's no prophet to listen to him, today it is our same Amir al-Sunnah, but when it comes to Zul Mulaqat, the queue will stretch for miles and miles and miles, still people will not get a chance to meet him. And that is the respect, that is the status that Allah Ta'ala has given to this person of his. And my dear son, that is the effort he made for Dawud Islamic, that is the effort he made for this. It says that there were some days when he used to go out to do tabligh, to give bayan, to give dars in the masajid. He didn't used to even get back home at night. He says that by the time I used to finish, the last train had already gone. He used to spend his night in that area. He spent days away from home. He spent days away from his family, weeks, months. Why? To propagate the deen, to do tabligh of the deen. Now this is a time for us to think. Alhamdulillah, this night, blessed night. This beautiful night for us, the 26th of Ramadan, where we remember this great ni'mat of Allah Azza wa Jalla upon us. But it's a time for us to ponder as well. That if this one person can give so much sacrifice for the deen, look at the achievement that he has done, then can't we even sacrifice a short time? Can't we even sacrifice 2 hours a week to come to the weekly Ijtima? Can't we sacrifice 3 days a month to travel on the Madani Qafila? These brothers, they talk about it all the time. Every bayan, every dirt, every time they say something, they talk about Qafila. Qafila, Qafila, all the time. Why are they always talking about this? They don't work on commission. They don't get money every time they mention the word Qafila. They are telling you about Qafila because they see the benefits of the Madani Qafila. It is this Madani Qafila that Amir al-Sunnah started in Karachi approximately 29 years ago. Alhamdulillah, that has spread today to over 150 countries. That is Alhamdulillah Dawat Islami in front of you. And this is my reason, this is what Amir al-Sunnah did. And let me tell you this, it's very easy. You know, we joined this Mahal of Dawat Islami. It was easier for us to do than it was 30 years ago for Amir al-Sunnah. It's very easy. In this country, what do we say? There's a saying to join the bandwagon. Yeah? It's very easy to jump on a train when everybody's going in the same direction. Yeah? It's very easy to join a group or an organization when that organization is very popular. It's very easy to do something when everybody else in your community is doing exactly the same thing. But what is hard, my dear family brothers, is to do the opposite. And at a time when the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was engrossed in sin, the masajid were becoming empty. People were engrossed in sin. People were giving more attention to the knowledge of the dunya rather than the knowledge of the deen. People were getting very far away from the deen. People were engaged in adultery, lying, backbiting, all of these kind of things. And at that time, this tide of sin, this huge wave of sins, it was engulfing everybody. And at that time, it would have been very easy for everybody, including the mirror listeners, to say that, look, you know, this is not just my problem. This is not on my shoulders. You know, these youngsters are on the street. It's their parents' fault. These people who are alcoholics, it's their own fault. These people who smoke drugs every week, it's not my problem. Let them deal with it. That's the easy answer, my dear family brothers. So Amir al-Sunnah did not choose the easy answer. I mean, what did he do? It takes courage, my dear family brothers. It takes commitment and it takes character at that time to stand up and walk in the opposite direction. And that is precisely what our beloved Amir al-Sunnah did. That is when Amir al-Sunnah started Dawat Islami, and it is that Dawat Islami today which is spread to 150 countries. Alhamdulillah, this is the work of Amir al-Sunnah. This is the difference that he has made to the people of this world, my dear family brothers. Alhamdulillah, when we're talking about the difference that he has made, how he has changed people's lives, I'll give you some examples. The same brothers who would walk on the street with fashionable hair, with lines in their head and all sorts of hairstyles. Many of them do this today, you will see, before you wearing an imamah sharif on the head. That change from where we were to where we are, that change was brought about by Amir al-Sunnah. That's one example, my dear son of brothers. Many of the brothers that you see, there was a time when they were clean, they used to stand in front of the mirror and shave their beard. Then brothers today, alhamdulillah, now they have a beard on their face. That is because of Amir al-Sunnah. Many brothers you see, They were the type of people that every year when it came to Eid or any sort of thing, they would go to the shops and buy the latest designer clothes. Some very same brothers you will see today who are dressed from head to toe according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That might be some of it because of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. These changes in people, this revolution in people has been brought about by Amir Ahlul Sunnah. And let me give you a beautiful story of this one individual, one person, and from that you will see how Amir Ahlul Sunnah is revolutionizing the people, the lives of the people. It says that there was a youngster in Karachi, and this youngster, he had a habit of watching films, watching movies. He says, I used to watch one movie every single day. And music, he used to listen to so much that he used to take a tape recorder with him every night before he went to sleep. Then what happened was one day this youngster, somebody passed him a bayan of Amir Ahlul Sunnah entitled Jahannam Ki Tabahkariyan. He says, I listened to that bayan and it had a massive impact upon me. Massive impact on me. And he says that because of listening to that bayan, I ended up sitting in 8 o'clock for the last 10 days of Ramadan in that year. Alhamdulillah, like many of you lucky brothers here today, I sat in 8 o'clock. This brother, he says, first time in my life, I sat in 8 o'clock under the banner of Dawat Islami. And he says, I carried on to learn. He says, my friends came and they started mocking me, making fun of me. They said, you know, you're just joking around with these people. But he says, I told them that I have changed. He says, I told them that I have made a change for the better. And this brother entered Dawat Islami. Alhamdulillah, he adorned this beautiful environment of Dawat Islami. And who is that brother? Let me tell you that that same brother came into Dawat Islami. He made progress. He rectified himself. That brother today is none other than Nigrani Shura Haji Imran Atari. Look at the revolution that Amir Ahlul Sunnah brought to his life. And what does he say? Ke phirta tha mara mara, na tha koi sahara, a pahuncha main bhi sunkar, attar rehnuma hai. Tera karam hai baapa, jo laga liya hai seene, ab jaun kyun main dard dard. Attar rehnuma hai. Marisa, this is Amir Ahlul Sunnah, is the guide for that one person, for me, for you, for all of his people, for hundreds and thousands, for the whole of the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is that personality who can change the lives of people. And this is why today the scholars, the ulama, the mashayikh, they are lining up to sing the praises of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. You see yourself on Madani Channel every single day. Every single day on Madani Channel, there is an alim-e-deen who wants to give his views about Madani Channel, who wants to give his views about Amir Ahlul Sunnah. And every single one of them has something positive to say. Every single one of them has something to say about Amir Ahlul Sunnah. There's a very big scholar of India, very, very famous name, very famous personality, very big scholar of India. And he did a visit to Fazan-e Medina in Karachi. And Nigrani Shura, he says, I met with him. And he says that this person, he came and he did a tour, and they showed him where the students of Jamiatul Medina study, Madrasa of Medina, the masjid, all these kind of things they showed him, all the different activities of Dawat Islami. They showed him, and when he was given a talk, what did he say? He says that a long time ago, he says, I saw a dream that there will be one day when Ahlul Sunnah can be proud of an organization that has everything inside it. He says, I saw that dream many years ago. And he says, today by coming to Fazan-e Medina, Alami Madani Markaz, he says, I have seen the reality of my dream. And this is one of the biggest scholars of India saying this, my dear Sangha. And he is one person. I'm telling you, there are literally hundreds. They are lining up. They will sign their signature. There's books full of their testaments, their testimonials about the personality of Amir Ahlul Sunnah. The Muftiyan-e Kiram, the Mashaykh, they are giving salat to Amir Ahlul Sunnah. They are saying that this person is a gift from Allah Azza wa Jalla to Ahlul Sunnah. And that is not something that they just saying to please him. This is a reality. No doubt Amir Ahlul Sunnah, this personality, in this time of fitna, in this time where people are moving away from the deen, Amir Ahlul Sunnah is a gift that Allah Ta'ala has bestowed upon us. And my dear family, we need to appreciate this gift. Why are the ulama talking about him like this? You know, there's many personalities. The world is full of people. Why so much about Amira and the Sunnah? Why are the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah so praiseworthy of this person? Because of the work that this person has done. Let me give you one example. One example of the work of Dawood-e-Islami. It says, a brother who wrote a letter to Amir al-Sunnah. And he said to Amir al-Sunnah, that the village in which I live, that village, there are three mosques. And he says that we are fearful that then mosques will be taken over by people with the wrong beliefs. People who will misguide the people. And he wrote a letter to Amir al-Sunnah that this is a time when we need the help of Dawood-e-Islami. So what did Amir al-Sunnah do? He sent a Madani Kafila to that masjid. And then a Madani Kafila to the next mosque. And a Madani Kafila to the third mosque as well. So the three mosques in this village. And it states that same village, that there was a threat that these mosques or this village could be taken over and people could misguide the ummah. People could misguide the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These Madani Kafilas, when Dawood-e-Islami gave attention to that area, alhamdulillah, today, every single year, there is a Mahfil and Milad in that masjid. Every single week, there is an Ijtema of Dawood-e-Islami. Every month, there is a Madani Kafilas of Dawood-e-Islami travel. Now, this is Dawood-e-Islami today. This is my Dawood-e-Islami, your Dawood-e-Islami, our Dawood-e-Islami. This is defending the Maslak of Ahl Sunnah. This is defending Maslak of Allah Hazrat. And this is not a small thing. This is not a small task. This is not a small achievement that this organization that started with one person who was the imam of a very small masjid that today has expanded to 150 countries. This organization, my dear Islamic brothers, is the future of Ahl Sunnah. And this, inshallah, if we work together, if all of you brothers come into Dawood-e-Islami properly and we work collectively, we work together, my dear Islamic brothers, inshallah, we could say that we have gone to 150 countries yet. Inshallah, we could double that within the next 30 years. When the brothers they told Amir al-Sunnah that alhamdulillah, the program of Dawood-e-Islami has reached so many countries, Amir al-Sunnah was happy naturally. But he said, what did he say? This is a sign of a wali of Allah Azza wa Jal. He said, don't be content. Don't become complacent. That, you know, we've done amazing. You know, 150 countries, there's no other organization that's done that. But Amir al-Sunnah says, don't get complacent and don't think to yourself, become content. He says, that's 150 countries. He says, there are still probably more than 150 where we still need to go. Our work is not done, Amir al-Sunnah said. So my dear Islamic brothers, that's not just the work for Amir al-Sunnah, that's the work for me and you as well. We need to help Amir al-Sunnah in that work. We need to enter this mahal of Dawood-e-Islami properly and help Amir al-Sunnah in that work. Now look what he has done for us. Amir al-Sunnah, for me and you, he has changed our life. And you know, brothers, they say, why does Amir al-Sunnah come to the UK? You know, when will Amir al-Sunnah bless this country as well with his presence? When is that time going to come when Amir al-Sunnah will come to the UK and we will go to the airport to welcome him and we will have these big ishtimas and all this kind of stuff? My dear Islamic brothers, Amir al-Sunnah himself physically may not be in the UK, but my dear, his work and spiritually, he is with us in the UK. There is a brother in the city of Blackburn. And this brother, he tells the true story in his own words. He says that I was in the environment of Dawood-e-Islami, and alhamdulillah, I did bayat with Amir al-Sunnah as well. And he says that alhamdulillah, I used to travel in the kafilas, but then after a while, I moved house, and the shaitan gradually started to work on me, and I started to get a distance from the mahal. And he says, what happened is that after some time passed, he says, I got into some bad friends. I got into a bad group of friends, and they started to invite me towards bad things. Anyway, this one day came when they all made a plan with friends that tonight we're going to go clubbing. And he says that I made this intention as well. So I got ready, put my clothes on, had a shower, got ready, and left the house. He says, I was on my way, and you know, there was a bit of guilt inside me, that maybe I shouldn't be doing this, So he says, my friends and the company and everything was just encouraging me. So what? Do it. We'll see what happens afterwards. So he goes, I'm on a journey. He goes, I'm about to cross the road. And he says that in the end, at the end of the road, I see a person wearing an Imam Sharif still at the corner. And he says, you can see the back of this person. And he says, I go close to see who this person is. And he says, it's Amir al-Sunnah. And he says that I felt so ashamed. So I felt so ashamed not to even be wearing a topi on my head in front of this Wali of Allah Azza wa Jal. He says, I felt so ashamed in myself. He says, I went straight back inside my house. I took off my clothes. He says, I had a read Isha Namaz. He goes, I made wuzu, I read Isha Namaz, I read Salatul Tawbah, and I asked for forgiveness from that sin, never to do that same thing again. So my dear son, because you could say Amir al-Sunnah is here with us in the UK. And one other way he is with us, and inshallah this is a message I want to deliver to you as well, is that these Madani in Ahmad cards that we hold in our pockets, that the brothers talk about it every week in the Ijtima, that the brothers be sat on the maktab every week and they send around text messages, Madani in Ahmad. My dear son, this Madani in Ahmad is Amir al-Sunnah talking to you every day. And if you were to say that from all this gathering, one person, he's going to get the chance to talk to Amir al-Sunnah over the phone. I think there will be a stampede in this place as to who's going to get that opportunity. Who's going to get to talk to Amir al-Sunnah on the phone? Yeah? But my dear son, Amir al-Sunnah is talking to you every single day in the form of Madani in Ahmad. And these Madani in Ahmad, he's asking you questions. Think to yourself, the questions, what are the questions? Did you read your 5-time namaz today? Think to yourself, a lot of us are students, yeah? Or we've been students. Think to yourself, your ustad every single day, the first question that he asks you, did you read your namaz today? And if we had the habit of missing our namaz, then wouldn't we feel embarrassed answering that question to him? You know, it would make a thing, wouldn't it? But yeah, this guy is asking me this question, we would feel embarrassed, and so we would try to rectify ourselves. Now this one, that would be if the ustad was asking us. This is Amir al-Sunnah asking us that question. And he's asking us not one question, but 72 questions in this Madani in Ahmad, and the purpose of the questions is for him to rectify us. My dear Sahib, just use that. Let's not let that opportunity go to waste. These Madani in Ahmad that Amir al-Sunnah has given us, let's try to act upon them as well. And what I was saying was, Amir al-Sunnah has done a lot for us. Not a single person here can deny what Amir al-Sunnah has done in terms of changing our lives. No doubt, when somebody does such a big favor upon you, if your mate, your best mate, he's always there for you, always whenever you call him, he's by your side. If he asks for something in return, would you want to give it to him? Of course you would. Yeah, today, just in the of Amir al-Sunnah. Yeah? Don't you want to give him a gift? Of course you want to give him a gift. He has done so much for us, Amir al-Sunnah. He has changed our life. Let's give something in return. But what does Amir al-Sunnah want from us? Does he want financial? Does he want money from us? No, Amir al-Sunnah, what does he say? Kare kya tar maal o daulat. Isse nahi chahiye hukumat. Ye tera talib hai jaane rahmat, shafi'e rahmat nabiyye ummat. Amir al-Sunnah doesn't want our money. He doesn't want our bank balance. He doesn't want any financial backing from us. What does Amir al-Sunnah ask? All he asks is to do the Madani work of Dawat-e-Islam. Think to yourself that there are many brothers potentially who are waiting for your infadi courses. They are waiting for you to knock on their door and invite them to this ijtima. They are waiting for you to become that reason for them to change their life as well. So my dear brothers, they are waiting. And how long are we going to keep them waiting for? Alhamdulillah, Dawat-e-Islam has come so far that we have very far to go yet. Our work, my dear Islamic brothers, is not done. We need to go a lot further. And the only way we can do that, my dear Islamic brothers, is all of us, we work collectively. If all of us, we unite, and we work upon this beautiful platform of Dawat-e-Islami. Alhamdulillah, within Dawat-e-Islami, you find everything. Dawat-e-Islami is purely non-political. The whole purpose of it is purely to propagate the true message of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So there is no reason for anybody to feel that this is not for me. This is not the environment for me. Alhamdulillah, this is a platform for everybody. And as today what we've been talking about is the leader of this organization. Any organization, you judge him by his leader. Any organization, if you want to judge it, you don't judge it by an individual person. But if you want to judge by an individual, then you look at the leader of the organization, and then you will see what the principles are of this organization. Alhamdulillah, the leader of this organization, the founder of Dawat Islami, is a Kamil Wali of Allah Azza wa Jal. And they say that every murid should believe that his peer is the best. Yeah? Now, the people here who are not Atari, they are not murid of Amir Ahl Sunnah. So everybody, if you look at the books of Tasawwuf, it says that every person who is dead, who's given his hand in somebody's hand, he should believe that his peer is the best. And Alhamdulillah, I believe 126% that my peer is the best. Alhamdulillah. There is no one like him. There is no one like him in the world. He is the best. Alhamdulillah, and we are lucky, my dear family, because we are so lucky that we have nisbat with this great person. This is that type of personality that we used to read about in the books. This is that personality that we used to think from a bygone era. There used to be people who used to talk about eating less, who used to talk about talking less, who used to talk about keeping your eyes lowered. That personality, Allah Ta'ala has favored upon us. We didn't deserve it, but Allah Ta'ala has given us this, that personality is with us today. And we are lucky, honestly we are lucky, that we have nisbat with him. May Allah Ta'ala keep this nisbat that we have with him steadfast, and may Allah Ta'ala keep it with this person for as long as we live in this world. And my dear family brothers, that message that I want to leave you with is Amir al-Sunnah, he likes people who do work. Yeah, not just people who talk about doing work, but people who do actual work. You've seen it yourself on Mazi channel. Amir al-Sunnah, how much love he gives to people. How much love he is showing to the Ummah. Now, we are his followers, we are his murid, we have the ability to act upon what has been said. Ameen, bijahin nabiyul ameen, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallu ala al-habib.
Please send us your views and ideas regarding the program which you have just viewed to the following email address, feedback@madanichannel.tv, or text to the following numbers 0301261176 and 0312492138 9 Sallallahu